Good morning, everybody. Good morning and welcome to Christ Church. It's a beautiful morning here in Charleston, and it's my joy to welcome you to worship. My name is David Donathan. I'm the Minister of Music here, and we have a great service planned for you this morning. And of course, we'll be sharing in the Sacrament of Holy Communion. So good morning to all of you that are here in the centrum and those of you who are joining us online this morning. We're going to start by singing two songs. To get us going into our worship service. The first one is entitled, Come Now is the Time to Worship. So let's stand and sing. The words will be up on the screens. This is Come Now is the Time to Worship. One, two, three. Song is in worship in song. This is entitled Table of Plenty as we celebrate the Sacrament of Holy Communion. Table of Plenty, number 3173.
Come to the feast of heaven.
let's gather our hearts together for a moment of prayer. Gracious God, we thank you so much for bringing us safely into your house on this beautiful, beautiful Sunday morning. As we look forward to feeling your presence in this very space, we know that you are with us not only on this morning, but in all the days and weeks in the past and those days and weeks in the future. We lift before you those things that we carry on our hearts and minds, and we ask that you always bless us as we move forward in being your light and your love in this world. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you would, turn to those around you and welcome them to worship this morning.
Welcome you again. I'm Pastor Jay, lead pastor. We're glad you're here with us. Again, those of you online and those of you here in the Centrum, we're so glad to see everybody out this morning. As we gather, we will, of course, gathering for our time of prayer. I wanted to share a few prayer concerns that have come forward to us. Again, we collect the prayer concerns from the folks that come and join with us at the assistance ministry, and many of them ask to pray for them. Their families who have been struggling, they're having difficulty. One individual indicates she was pregnant and, of course, had lost their job and were dealing with those issues of what brought them, of course, to the assistance ministry. Another one was a recent widow, was not having a good time and was really struggling, and we spent some time with her this week. Another one needed prayer for her family. Another one was a home was destroyed by the city, leaving their family without any housing. And so again, many of the folks that come to us for assistance ministry come again for financial assistance, but also spiritual assistance. I'm thankful for Shirley and the others who provide care to them as they come and spend time with us. I invite us also, of course, to remember those in our community who are, you know, struggling with illness, some that may be wrestling with that, and those that continue to wrestle with the loss of loved ones. As we know, this weekend is the anniversary of Leah Strickland's death, and so we can lift up the Strickland family as it's been a hard weekend for them, so we want to remember them as well. Also, those of us that Again, listen to a lot of music. I know I got some friends that are parrot heads. I've been praying for them with the passing of Jimmy Buffett. I know that sounds odd, but for many people, music touches their hearts, and the thought of losing someone whose songs touch their hearts so deeply, I've been thinking a lot about my parrot head buddies that used to go to his concerts. So let's remember them as well. Are there prayer concerns that you may have here in the community? I invite you to lift them up, those that are gathered here. Anything on your hearts or minds? Okay. Those of you that are joining us online, we do invite you, as always, to share your prayer concerns through the chat feature on Facebook, and we'll gather those and collect them with our other prayer concerns. We're moving into a prayer initiative course coming up this month of September. We'll hear more about that. But again, I want us to really think about our prayer life in these days and weeks ahead. And what does it mean to be a community in prayer? It is one of those things that I think God calls us to do. As we'll hear in a moment, it's part of the work of the church. And so I invite us all now to kind of center our hearts, our minds, our spirits, wherever we are here in the centrum, those of you online, as we come together in this time of community prayer. God of grace and power and love, you call us to be your people. Call us to come together as a community of faith. Call us to be a people of prayer. So today, oh God, we unite our hearts, our minds, our spirits. We come to you as a collective body, offering our prayers of thanksgiving for your love and your grace and your power in our lives. Offering our prayers for those who labor as we celebrate this Labor Day weekend. We give thanks for those who work so tirelessly in the past century to enable us to have a 40-hour work week, to have leave time, to keep children out of the factories. All those things that we forget were part of our collective experience, but now are not. As we recognize the value of work and labor, yet also the value of the worker and the laborer. And so we give thanks for all those who work and labor, and even those who aren't able to be off this weekend due to the nature of their work and continue to labor. But you've also called us, oh God, to be a church, to be a people who perform your work of love, your work of grace, this work of the church that empowers us to be your light in this community, the work of the church that enables us to truly do the work of building your kingdom. We know it's based on you, Lord, that all these things happen. And so we pray that you would continue to pour your spirit upon us here at Christ Church, that we would continue to do the work of the church. That we would continue to be a community of faith, hope, and love, serving our neighbors in the world as your hands. We pray that you would be with those in our community who need your grace today, those who are struggling, those who continue to mourn the passings of loved ones, those who just need a word of uplift to put that next foot in front of the other. We pray for those beyond our walls who we seek to assist through monetary assistance and giving support. But we pray especially, oh God, for your world, a world who cries out for us to gather together to do your work of building this thing called the kingdom of God, a kingdom of grace, a kingdom of power, and most especially a kingdom of love. And we do so as we follow in the footsteps of the one who called us to this work, this Jesus the Christ, who invites us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right. I'd like to invite Joe Mastracy to come up and share the children's message with us. Those of you watching online, be sure to gather around the screen so you can hear Joe's message.
Come on, let's have a seat here. Over here. All right, on the count of three, we're going to say good morning real loud. All of you, ready? One, two, three. Good morning! And it is a good morning. We're so glad to be here. We have some really cool things to talk about, but first we're going to play a little game. And I need everyone's help out here to play this game too. You won't be on camera, but these guys will. And I'm still going to look and see if everyone's playing this game. So this game is called Expressions. And you have to stand still or sit still. You can't make any sounds. You just have to, if I say something, you got to make a face and not make any sound, just sitting still. All right? So if I say happy, what does that look like with your face? Okay, happy. What does sad look like? Show me. Oh, that's a good sad face. Oh, look at that. It looks like a puppy dog up here. Okay. Well, if I say sick, what does that look like? Oh. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you don't look too healthy right now. Okay, if I say excited, what does that look like? Oh, yeah, yeah. So I want to tell you about one of my favorite books in the Bible. One of my favorite books in the Bible is ironically called James. And it's not one of my favorite books in the Bible just because your name is James, but because it tells us as Christians how to live. And what we should do. It's not enough just to believe in God, but what do our actions look like as Christians? So when I say happy, what does that look like again? What does happy look like? In the book of James, it tells us when we're happy, we need to pray. So can you do this? So if I say happy, show me happy again. And now pray. If we're sad, what does that look like again? We pray. Even if we're happy, we pray to God and we thank him. And if we're sad, we ask him for help. And if we're sick, what does that look like again? Oh, yeah. Then we do what? We pray. All the time, we're a people of prayer. We pray to God and we thank him and we ask him for help and support. Can you remember that for me? All right. All right, who's ready to pray now? Now that we've done all these emotions, now let's pray. Okay? Repeat after me. Dear God, we thank you that we can come to you no matter how we feel. If we're sick, if we're happy, if we're sad, we can still come to you. Help us to feel your love and to go out and do great things. In Jesus' name, big amen. Ready? Amen. All right. Let's go back. Your mommy's teaching Sunday school.
All right. Thank you so much, Joe. And the little ones there. We appreciate you so much. Now, as we gather for a moment to share a few of the announcements, again, you'll be hearing a lot more about the Breakthrough Prayer Initiative throughout the month of September. You'll see information about that and your trifold and also part of our sharing today in worship and in the weeks ahead, so please keep that in mind. Also, the United Methodist Men will be gathering for their first gathering of kind of this new church year this Thursday, gathering down at the Scout office for a cookout where we'll be actually sharing a bit about the prayer initiative there. But we encourage all the men to come out and join in that time of fellowship. I've got to get my trifold here, make sure I'm not missing anything. Again, the Worship and Arts Ministries are beginning their new season. I know David's all geared up and ready for that. You'll see a listing of a lot of the fall activities. activities that will be coming up. We're trying to do some new things this year, the kind of the happy hour and hymns thing, having a breakfast church once a month at 9:45. So watch your schedule for these new things as we try to live into this new church year, doing new and innovative things. Of course, it is the Labor Day weekend, so the church office will be closed tomorrow, but staff should all be here on Tuesday ready to respond to any and all of your needs. Since it is the first Sunday of the month, I would like to invite Shirley Jakes to come up to share about our assistance ministry. I know I probably didn't let the sound folks know that, but we'll need the podium mic on for Shirley, if you would. Yes.
Good morning. This past week, it seemed like we had more touching stories than normal. So I'd like to tell you about a few of the people who came. There was the lady who had the tree fall through the roof of her house, and then the heavy rains came through. So she is displaced along with her 5 children at this time. There was a lady who had been homeless for months and has finally been approved for HUD housing. However, she owes some past utility bills, and those have to be paid before she can move. She's currently sleeping on the floor at a friend's house. There was an older gentleman, older than me, that makes him really old, who was a veteran. He had served in 2 conflict zones in his life. He could barely walk. There was the young woman whose husband had been killed in May, leaving her a widow with 3 children. She could barely make it through the day and care for her children. She was really struggling. And you know, besides the financial assistance that we give these people, I think that they also appreciate that we try to take time to listen to these stories and to hold them up. And I think in doing so, when they come into this house of God, they're able to feel the presence of God. And because you give, we can help them keep the lights on, the water running. And I hope that you will continue to do so. Because every time you do this, you're acting as the hands of Christ. You can place a contribution and the offering plate at the door as you leave, or you can send in a check or stop by anytime you want and designate an offering for the assistance ministry. Thank you.
Thank you, Shirley, and all your team that works with our assistance ministry. If you come in here on Tuesday, you see the good work being done, and you see people's needs being met. Just like many of our ministries here at Christ Church, we're reaching out and touching our world in wonderful ways, and we thank you for your gifts that help make that possible, your special gifts for assistance ministry, as well as your general gifts that go to reach the other ministries that are reaching our world. So now I invite you to share in our time of tithes and offerings as the band shares a song, "As We Seek, Jesus, Draw Me Close."
As we
Yeah, thank you, David, for that beautiful song. I want to share with you a couple of lessons today as we come into our time of worship. The first one comes to us from the book of Acts. It's the second chapter of Acts, the verses 42 to 47. Speaking of those first disciples, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. This is the word of God. Then our second lesson comes to us from the book of James, chapter 5, verses 13 to 18. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another, so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. Again, words of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Holy and living God, as we gather in your house this day here on this Labor Day weekend, and as we prepare our hearts for this new prayer initiative in the life of our church, I pray that these simple words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, for you ever and always are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, today's the Sunday of Labor Day weekend. It's a time when kind of our summer activities come to a close, and we begin to celebrate perhaps with that last hurrah of summer, a time of maybe a picnic or a barbecue or a boating outing or a camping trip. It's a time when we focus our attention on work by taking off from work, right? And when we do so remembering, as I mentioned in our prayer, those who labored and who organized for better working conditions, for better working hours for the American worker. I think we sometimes forget how difficult it was in the early years of the Industrial Revolution and the way workers were treated. They were often treated miserably. And so we take this weekend to remember and to give thanks for good work and good working conditions, the 40-hour week, the 8-hour workday, all of those things that we sometimes take for granted. But since this is a weekend when culturally we're focusing on work and Labor Day, I thought it would also be a real appropriate time for us to think about what is the work of the church. What is our work to be about? You know, in our first lesson in Acts today, we read of those first Christians. And we remember that in the second chapter, this is kind of right after the outpouring of the Spirit at Pentecost. And we read about how they gathered and organized themselves. And we're told that they gathered together and they focused on certain things. Their foci being seen of kind of like the hallmarks of who they were and what they were about. They were practices which gave them their identity as Christian people. In some respects, I think these were the primary work or the primary tasks of the church, because they were the foundational activities through which all their other work came. And what were they? Well, first, devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. And then secondly, to gathering together in fellowship. Third, the breaking of the bread. And then fourth, prayer. You know, these were the keys. They were the central features of their life together in living out their faith. And so too do I sense they should be central to our focus as contemporary expressions of the church. I think they should be central to our work here at Christ Church United Methodist. Not that our other activities are bad. Hardly. The assistance ministry, going out in mission. I know some of our folks went out in mission. I forgot to lift that up. I know Carolyn and some of them went out and I joined them. We helped muck out a house out Witcher Creek on Wednesday. Those are all wonderful things to do. They're the work of the church, and we love God's people through these outside activities. But I think they spring forth from these foundational actions, these foundational works that we do and practice together. And we do that. We, as a church, we devote ourselves to the apostles' teachings, partly by gathering here in worship, where we sing praises to God, and then we hear the word expounded upon, and we think about spiritual things, our Sunday school classes, our Bible studies, our book study groups. All of them do that same thing. They're trying to devote ourselves to the apostles' teachings and to learn from them. And through them, we connect with God, and we also connect with each other. Because that's just as important. You notice they said devote themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship. The fellowship is that coming together to support one another. And we do that too here in many different ways. From playing pickleball on Sunday afternoon and Thursday to the yarnets crocheting together. Those times of fellowship and coming together are ways that we support each other. And we grow together in our faith. That's part of the work of the church as we build community and support each other. And of course, as they mentioned, the breaking of the bread. Perhaps nothing is more central to who we are than this gathering around a special table. Having a meal together. Yes, we have potlucks and those are fun, but there's something about this table that truly sets us apart. Indeed, the liturgy that we share as we gather around this table is often called the work of the people, the work of the church. This practice is the most distinctive practice we do in perhaps separating ourselves from other faiths and those who worship differently. For in this holy meal, we remember the sacrifice the Lord made for us. And we renew ourselves through the sharing of the bread and the cup and remembering that night. It's a very mysterious moment. I can't tell you what all goes on here, but I know that the presence of Christ comes in a very special and mysterious way as we gather. That's why we do it at least once a month like we will here today. For it unites us anew with God through Christ and one another. And it's a practice that goes all the way back. Those early years of the church. These works of the church. Devotion to the apostles' teachings. Gathering together in fellowship. Sharing in the breaking of the bread and the gathering around the table. They're central to our identity. They are foundational to who we are. But then there's that fourth practice that's mentioned. Prayer. The practice of prayer. You see, prayer is the practice through which we communicate with God, and it's also the way in which God communicates with us. Simone Weil, the famed 20th century writer and mystic, notes that prayer in some respects is like a wall that you might have separating two prisoners in a jail. And what she meant by that was you have two prisoners that are in a jail cell and they can't see each other, but they would knock and they would communicate through the wall. The wall, in a way, separated them, but it was also the means through which they were able to communicate with one another. And I think prayer is like that. I mean, God, I can't see God. He's on the other side of the veil. I can't see God. I never one has. But through prayer, that veil becomes something through which we communicate. And the words go back and forth. The feelings go back and forth. So prayer is a way in which we connect with God, and then a way in which God also connects with us and shows us what to do. You know, a few years ago, the American Atheist put up a billboard outside of the Super Bowl about the time the Super Bowl was occurring. And it said, Hail Mary only works in football. And then they put out a press release that said, it's time to stop believing that prayer works. In a sense, I think the atheists have a point. I mean, when I pray for WVU to go good, they never do. Because I don't think prayer is about praying for my football team to win. I mean, I might ask that nobody get hurt in a game. But to pray about the outcome of a football game is probably not what prayer is about. But I think the American atheists were clearly wrong when they said that prayer does not work. Because prayer does change things. Because that early Christian community, if you'll remember, right before that outpouring of the Holy Spirit, they were gathered together in one place and they were praying. And then the power came and enabled them to become the community that literally changed our world, even to this very day. They turned the world upside down. Because you see, prayer has the power to change the people who pray. It can make us more peaceful, accepting, and connected to God. I mean, it may or may not be able to change the path of hurricanes or the outcome of football games, but it can change us. Because it draws us into a deeper relationship with the creator of this universe, the one who saves us. And when we ask for God's leadership and guidance, he can change the world through us. I'm reminded that one of the most well-known modern prayers, other than the Lord's Prayer, which we say every week, is the Serenity Prayer, that one attributed to Reinhold Niebuhr. It's central to almost every addiction recovery program in the world that works. It's a simple prayer. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. One thing we notice about this prayer is that the individual is not asking for God to somehow miraculously eliminate the desire for alcohol or narcotics. Instead, it's asking God to give serenity, to give peace and courage and wisdom so that the people may become well. In a book called How Al-Anon Works, it says, we turn to the God of our understanding for the attributes necessary to live life more fully. We turn to God of our understanding for the attributes necessary to live life more fully. In other words, praying people turn to God and ask for help to better their lives. And by praying to God in this way, millions of people have been able to maintain sobriety through these programs across our country and the world. And in each of these groups, the Serenity Prayer is said to change the hearts and minds of people, not the hearts and minds of God. And it empowers us, I think, in praying prayers to handle problems more effectively because we believe that God is with us. And that God is working with us and in us in every time and place and situation. Because I think one of the most important things about prayer is that it aligns us with the will of God. That's what prayer is about. It's seeking to align ourselves, to align our community, to bring everything we're about into this will of God. Prayer aligns us with God and God's will for us. Because we know that God wants for us serenity, courage, and wisdom regardless of what we're facing. Paul knew that when he spoke about how we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. Paul tells us also in other writings in Romans, neither death nor life nor anything else will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. You see, prayer changes us and draws us closer to God. And it gives us the skills to face the challenges of life. And it aligns us with God's will, a will that wants healing and wholeness for us, but also for this world. And that's one reason we want to do this breakthrough prayer initiative this September. I just want to speak to it for a minute. We're invited to join with churches throughout West Virginia to focus on opening ourselves to God's will, praying that He will show us His hope and dreams for us, praying that we will be able to hear that, to see that, and to follow that. And in doing so, we're going to be standing on the shoulders of centuries of people who have been praying that same way, going all the way back to these first disciples, who prayed that God would show them how to be followers of this Jesus. He'd gone on, and they didn't know how to do it. But in praying together, He poured His Spirit upon them, and they were empowered to go out and proclaim that good news. They were empowered to go out and start ministries that literally changed the world. They were the people whom the Romans said, look at those Christians. When plagues hit, they're the ones that went in and brought healing because they prayed and God empowered them to do that. Our initiative this September is to invite God to do the same in and through us, to change us as individuals, to release His power within us and as a community of faith. And I pray that you will join with us as we engage in it. I know it's the first Sunday of September, and you're saying, well, Jay, what are we supposed to do? Well, first, we just need to prepare ourselves to begin thinking about what prayer means to us and how we pray and when we pray. Because next week, when we gather, we'll give more resources. More resources that will enable us to pray as a community. For you see, that serenity prayer is a prayer that's prayed by every AA group everywhere. Because that prayer has power. Here at Christ Church next week, we are all going to be invited to pray the same prayer every day. Beginning September 10th. A prayer that will invite God to open our ears and our minds and our hearts. A prayer that will enable us to hopefully listen and follow and engage in a 28-day experiment. An experiment about what it means to be a community that all prays together every day. So I pray that you will join us online or in person so you can hear more about that. But as I said this week, I want you to just continue to pray as you've prayed. Pray for your church. Pray for your family. Pray for the needs that are on your heart. Pray for the needs of your neighbor. Do all those prayers that you've already done. For in this season, September here this fall, prayer will be our central focus. In praying that God will enable us to be who God wants us to be. A prayer that will open us to His power. A prayer that begins with us being silent and listening. The poet Longfellow, I think, captures the essence of this single-minded devotion that's at the heart of prayer. He writes, "Let us then labor for an inward stillness, an inward stillness and an inward healing. That perfect silence where the lips and heart are still and we no longer entertain our own imperfect thoughts and vain opinions. But God alone speaks in us and we wait in singleness of heart, that we may know his will, and in the silence of our spirits, that we may do his will, and do that only. As sisters and brothers, let us be the people of the church, people who do that work of prayer, that work of devotion, that work of fellowship, that work of gathering for this special meal. Because if I've learned anything in my last 20-some years, the atheists are wrong. Prayer does change things, but it begins by changing us. So let us join in a time of silent prayer and confession as we prepare to gather around the table. Oh God, hear our prayer. Our Lord invites to his table all who love God and seek to live in grace with one another. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven for whatever has been burdening your heart. For today, as we join in the long history of a community different from the rest of the world, a community who gathers around a table not simply to share steak and potatoes or whatever we desire, but to share a special meal, a meal in which we remember and re-experience that time when Jesus was gathered with just a few of his friends in an upper room. Things weren't going well. The Romans were, and the Jewish leaders were at the door. But as they shared that meal together, he paused, and he took bread. And he gave thanks to God. And then he broke that bread. And he gave it to his friends, saying, "Take, eat. For this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then after the meal, he paused again. And he gave thanks to God. And he took the cup and said, "This is my blood that is poured out for you. And for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And then he gave it to his friends. As we gather here this day, we pray that God would pour his Spirit out upon us and upon these simple gifts of bread and juice, such that they may be for us this day the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Until that day in which we can gather together with all those who've gone before us at that great banquet in heaven. Let us share again the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is the body of Christ, the one whose body was broken, that we might have life. The cup of salvation poured out for us and for all people. I'd like to invite Joe to come up. He was going to help me serve today. A little shot of this. We'll be doing it by intention today. We invite you to come up and receive a piece of bread and dip it in the cup. We also have the individual cups for those that feel more comfortable with that. The individual cups are also gluten-free. So we invite you to come and share in this moment around the table, joining with all those who've gone before us. Let us pray. Holy and living God, we pray that you would pour your Spirit out upon us as you poured it out upon those first disciples, those who too gathered around this table seeking your light, seeking your life. As we rise from this table, may that Spirit move through us as we go out into your world seeking to help you in building the kingdom. The kingdom of love and grace. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I invite you to stand as we join in our closing hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And I want you to sing it loud because this is my grandmother's favorite. All right? thank you for indulging me. I love this old song. My sisters and brothers, may we go forth trusting in the grace of a God whose power is waiting to break through in our lives. The power of grace that he wants to pour upon us so that we can go forth and give that grace to others. So let us be in prayer this week in preparing ourselves for this breakthrough initiative right here at Christ Church. Go forth in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.